Growing up, my grandma always told me that the land took care of us, and it still is taking care of us, and it never asked for anything back.
We have a matriarchal lineage to our Aboriginal mothers, and our Aboriginal mothers are the direct connection to the land for thousands of years.
The land plays a big factor in who we are. That's what makes us strong. That's what makes us strong people.
Good evening, everyone. On behalf of Calgary Public Library, I would like to welcome you all to tonight's program in partnership with the Department of Classics and Religion at the University of Calgary. Before we start, I would like to acknowledge that February is the Black History Month as well. And as the library always participates in the campaign, we would like to do that now as well. This year, the Alberta Media Arts Alliance Society had to move this campaign online, and I would like to invite you to watch the Heritage Minute video about Viola Desmond with us.
All I wanted was to see a movie. One down, please.
I can't sell downstairs tickets to you people.
How dare they? I could afford to buy the more expensive ticket. I run my own business. But they refuse to take my money. They left me there all night.
On what charge?
They said I didn't pay the theater tax. But it was really about color.
Sister Desmond, appeal this conviction and your community will stand behind you.
Do you have any idea what this will do to us?
So what are you going to do?
Make it right.
Viola Desmond's case inspired Nova Scotia's civil rights movement. She was pardoned 63 years later based on the injustice of her conviction.
Thank you. So tonight's program is Byzantine identity in a pluralist society, and it is part of the Ancient World series. The presentation is being recorded and later will be available online through our YouTube channel. During the presentation, please feel free to submit your questions through the chat and we will read them at the end. And now I would like to introduce our tonight's guest speaker, Scott Coleman. Scott Coleman graduated from Memorial University of Newfoundland with a Bachelor of Arts Honors degree in History. He is currently a second year student of Master's Studies in Greek and Roman Studies at the University of Calgary. Scott's current research focuses on the function and identity of the Byzantine settlement at Çadır Hoyuk in north central Anatolia, Turkey. His thesis explores the complex relationships between archaeological material culture and historical literary evidence in order to understand the settlement's possible identity, functionality, and purpose on a local and regional scale. Scott's other research interests are in Byzantine numismatics, material culture, and how Byzantine identity is presented and represented in museums, as well as early Christian representations of female martyrs. Scott, over to you.
All right, let's see here, make sure everybody can hear me. And okay, so I'm just going to share my screen and then we'll get going here in just a moment. Okay, so hopefully everybody can see this. And I thank you very much for attending this talk. I'm just kind of give you a bit of a background first. This talk is kind of, if you watched this. I did a talk a couple weeks ago at the Nickle at Noon series. So this talk is similar to that one. So if you did attend that, I apologize that you might find some very familiar slides, but there is some extra content into this as well. So the title is Byzantine Identity in a Pluralist Society, Reflections on My Graduate Practicum Experience in Roman and Byzantine Numismatics. And kind of what I want to start off first is just what I mean by pluralist society. I mean, basically, it means that Canada is a diverse society that tolerates each other's beliefs, cultures, values, and so forth. It used to be multiculturalism, but it's kind of now turned on to the more neutral term of pluralist. So that being said, the overview of my talk today is going to be start off with who I am. What is Byzantium? For some people, they just haven't heard of this before. I know I never heard of it until I actually entered into university. And I was introduced to it by my current graduate supervisor, Dr. Marika Cassis. From there, I'm going to go into what is numismatics? What do numismatists do? And then how I got introduced into the Nickle Galleries at the University of Calgary and the collections that we hold. And this is what really got me thinking about how we represent identity through coins in museums. And it was this particular program that did that for me. And this is why I kind of want to focus on that today. So within that directed studies program, I want to look at the goals, how I got thinking about museums and coins, the context that we use, and go through a bit of, a quick little snapshot of different images of coins and how they change, but how we, and also look at how we label these coins through museum collections. From there, I'm going to look into some digital visualization that I've been working on and help me. This project got me rethinking about how I wanted to reimagine presenting coins to people and the identities that we associate with these coins. And then from there, kind of just close out with discussing what direction this has led me to in terms of future research and some outside activities that I'm partaking in. So that being said, we'll just continue on. So who am I? Well, as I've been introduced, I'm a second year MA student here at the University of Calgary in Greek and Roman Studies. And my research does focus on middle Byzantine rural settlement. So roughly around the 8th, 9th century up to the end of the 11th century, and looking at the identity of these settlements. I'm also very interested in obviously coins, that's the point of this current talk, and the representation of identity in coins. This picture, just so you know, it's me. This is at Chatterhoyuk itself. We had dug up a few things. What I was really excited about actually was I found some jaw bones there, and just before we took up that floor, I had to get a picture of me with this pit where we found everything in it. So, first off, what is Byzantium? So Byzantium is kind of a misnomer in terms of what we study. We actually, I always like to say I study the Eastern Roman Empire when I can. The term Byzantium came into common use actually in the late 19th century and tended to focus on the art and the architectural structures of this society, which kind of understood themselves as Romans. And this kind of misnomer came about by a particular person by the name of Edward Gibbon. A lot of us Byzantinists like to cringe at his name now, but he did kind of set the trend in terms of Byzantine studies. And what he did though was in his influential study, I guess you would say, it's called The History of the Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire, which was written in the late 18th century, kind of just stigmatized Byzantium it as a servile and effeminate Greek society, and that was kind of separate from the Romans, who the Roman Empire, and these people were full of corruption and decadence, and it just othered them and orientalized them. So we kind of turned around and we're trying to decolonize and deorientalize what Byzantium is now, and it's a very tough task to do given the history of in terms of how the studies have progressed. But to give you a sense of where Byzantium is, I'll start off there. So this particular slide is a slide of Byzantium at the height of Justinian I's empire. So if we look at it, the main heart of Byzantium is this orange area here, which is now modern Greece, Turkey, through to Egypt, and then through the Levant. But at the height of Justinian's reconquest to try to bring back the old glory of the Roman Empire, he did conquer lands into Italy, northern Africa, where Tunisia, Libya are, Morocco, and into southern Spain. So this map is meant to give you a breadth of the diversity of people that lived within the empire itself. And a lot of these people did call themselves Romans, but again, we don't really attach that name to them. And I'll get to that in a little bit here. So the main question is, and within the field, well, I shouldn't say the main question, but one of the questions we seem to address is, when does this society begin? When does this label of Byzantium should come into existence in a sense of representing these people? So there's a few kind of ways we approach this. And some people say it's with the founding of Constantinople, which is in 330 CE. Some people also, think it's during the fall of the Rome of the Western Roman Empire. So when the city of Rome itself was conquered in 476. Others have attested to 527, 566, a rule of Justinian. And some attested to the mid 7th century. And this is during the period of the Arab incursions or Muslim invasions, as it has been called, and sometimes even from that point on called the Dark Ages. We do know when the empire ends, which is 1453, the fall of Constantinople, when the Ottomans come in and lay siege to the city, take it, and then they form the Ottoman Empire, which lasts up until, you know, the end of the First World War. So, well, the other thing about this, when we look at Byzantium, is the monetary system and the coins that are here. And, oops, sorry about that. What happens is, with coins, we actually use 498 roughly as the period to start Byzantine coins. And why is that? And that's because a particular emperor by the name of Anastasius did a reform and reformed the whole monetary system, except for one particular coin. So most numismatists tend to use this particular date as the start of Byzantine coins. And you'll kind of see why when we get later into the presentation. So who are these people that lived in the society? Well, Anthony Kaldelis, who is a renowned Byzantine scholar and historian, argues that most of the Byzantine population identified as ethnic Romans and who lived in a land called Romania, which is Roman land in translation. There are other scholars who agree with him. I'm definitely one of them. But we have to also take into consideration that the sources that this particular scholar uses, and this is a small criticism, but nothing big, but are very elitist sources. So they come from the upper ends of society. The lower end society was full of multi-ethnic groups. So Armenians, religious groups like Jews, there are Arabs who lived within the society, both before Islam came along and after Islam. And there are all other types of groups that are coming in from the Balkan regions as well. So it is a very multi-ethnic culture, and with most people referring themselves as ethnic Romans. And as you can see with the map that I had shown earlier, that it is a very diverse empire given the geographical scope. So why do we keep using Byzantium or Byzantine? Well, it's basically an industry standard. We just kind of kept this going because it kind of just became part of scholarship, and no one has really set any motions to kind of change it. There's few people now that are starting to speak up and saying like, well, you know, we should probably call this the Eastern Roman Empire or Romania, so forth, like I mentioned earlier. But Byzantine studies is the name itself has kind of just stuck with us. So what is numismatics? It's basically the study of coins, paper, and metals. And as numismatists, we study these things and look at different variations of it. So some of us will look at the iconography or the images of the coin itself. Others will study monetary circulation, where these coins go. That's one of the things I like to do, actually, is looking at where coins come from and how they interact with people in society. And others do it on a larger economic scale in terms of inflation and so forth with the Byzantine economy. So to begin, like, why did I start with coins? Well, basically for me, it was the 26th field season of Chatterhoyuk. And this is right up here in this, up here. I don't know if you can see my cursor. I hope you can. It's in the north central part of Anatolia. It is a, Hoyuk is a man-made mound, which is down on the lower part of your slide on the right-hand side. And what that does is it's occupation layers built on top of each other. And the people who live there just keep reusing the material or finding new material and build on top of each settlement. Hoyuk is actually a Turkish word for a man-made mound. And there's other terms for this. Tell is one of them from in Arabic and so forth. So as I started working with this in this excavation in the 2016 season, I came across this one particular coin. And this is kind of where I get hooked into numismatics. And it's this particular coin here of Justin II and his wife, Sophia. And this coin wasn't, we weren't really sure who was on this coin. And I did some research that season as part of a project and I was able to identify this coin. So this got me really excited. But what was interesting about this particular coin, and I've mentioned this before in another previous talk, is this particular, right down below on the right-hand side of your screen, there's a T over here, T, H, E, U, P. And that is actually the minting mark of this coin and where it came from. And it's actually minted at a place called Theopolis, which was Antioch. And it, they changed the name after an earthquake had hit the city and pretty did a fair amount of destruction. And they just, when they start rebuilding it, they renamed it. But this coin comes from here. And if we look at some of the other marks, what we can see is on this, on the viewer's left side of the coin is Anno, A-N, and there's an O, but it's corroded. And then over on the viewer's right is an X with a I underneath, and that's 11. And that means it's the 11th year of the emperor's rule. And then, so in this case, this coin was minted in Theopolis during the 11th year of the emperor Justin II's rule. So the big M in the center is the value of the coin. It means 40 numi, which is one phallus, which is what it equates to in terms of the value coin. And this is the coin that I was talking about that Anastasius reformed and created. It was a whole new way of doing a currency in the empire. Now, when I dug a little bit deeper into this to kind of give you a better sense of why I got really into coins, it wasn't because of just these symbols and where it came from, but also the fact that if you look up at the top of your screen, Justin ruled from 565 to 574. That is not 11 years. What happened was is that Justin actually, not 100% sure, but he had fits, different mental fits, probably epilepsy, but I'm not 100% sure on this from the research I've done. But what happened was he had someone come in and rule in his stead. And this person was Tiberius, and Sophia stayed on as regent as well. So to ensure the power still stayed within his grips, but Tiberius was ruling in his place. So this is intriguing that the coin is still minted under Justin II's name in the 11th year of his rule, but it's under a regency in someone else's rule. And this kind of got me thinking, well, is this even Justin II on the coin? You know, is this maybe that other person on the coin, or is it Justin II and this guy's just doing him a favor and just like, hey, I'll take over the empire until you die, basically, and then I'll take it over completely, which is pretty well what happens. So this is really cool. Now, the other interesting fact is where this thing was made. Antioch and Theopolis is way down here, down on the southern borders of Turkey, bordering Syria. This coin traveled 400 kilometers as the crow flies to Chatterhoyuk. Now, obviously, it doesn't go directly there. The coin goes maybe up some road. It passes through the Silica Gates, maybe, and then comes up north. Or it could have even gone up through the northern part of Mesopotamia and then cut across. Who knows? It might even gone to Constantinople and come back. The thing about this is that how did it get our site and who was using this coin? It's not a fancy coin. It's just a bronze coin. It's nothing glamorous. It's nothing shiny. It doesn't have a huge amount of value, but there is some form of value to the coin, and it's showing up at our site with a few other coins. So it tells me that there are some people here who actually are carrying money with them to our little remote area in Anatolia. So this is some of the things that really intrigued me and got me thinking about the relationships coins have with people, what we can do with these coins, how we can kind of dissect social structures with coins, and all the different interactions of coins. So at the when I came to the University of Calgary, I got introduced to the Nickle Galleries, and I did not know about the collection they had. But when I got here, I was astounded about the size of it. I mean, we have about, I think about 19 to 20,000 coins in our collection. Not all of these are Byzantine. So there's Greek coins, there's Roman coins, there's Persian coins, there's we have Canadian money, we have Ottoman money, we have Islamic. So there's a wide breadth of stuff here. And I was just really enthralled by all this. So I got talking to Marina Fisher, who's the collection specialist, and we kind of started working together with some of these projects. And what I started doing this year was, before the COVID pandemic hit, I was like, I started a course up, or I shouldn't say sorry, I asked to have a course started up. And this was part of my directed studies and practicum. So what I wanted to do was, I wanted to start prepping for a trip that I was going to do in the upcoming year. And what I was planning on doing was, I was meant to go to Athens to study the massive Byzantine coin collection at the Agora, which is the Athenian Agora, which was a massive market during the Roman Byzantine period. Excuse me. So this practicum and directed studies program was set up to help me prep for this, and then to understand how coin collections work, how we process coins, curate them, identify them, and at the same time provide a better understanding about the production of coins and who's using them, and to help kind of facilitate my MA thesis that I'm currently working on. But as we all know, COVID happened and things started to change. So sitting at home, because I had had access to the collection, I started thinking about a research topic why I worked at home. And I started looking at how Byzantine coins were being represented in museums. The focus of this particular research was on Greek museums, actually, since that was pretty well where I was going to head to, was into Greece. And I started looking at how these museums were using Byzantine material culture and Byzantine coins to represent a link between the modern nation state of Greece to the classical world. And what was happening was, always this literature going, yeah, we come from the classical world. We have heritage with the classical world through the Byzantines to the modern state, but nothing was ever really explained how they were doing this, how they're talking, how this link with Byzantium was being created. And now the Byzantines spoke mostly Greek. It was their official language, in a sense. All imperial documents and so forth were done in Greek. But we also have Byzantine documents that are done in Latin. We have some in Syriac. There's a diversity of languages. So to say that it's a strictly Greek kind of connection is, again, a bit problematic and misleading. So I started looking at what museums do. How do they obtain coins and so forth? So some of the questions I went into this is through this kind of what I call a Byzantine paradox, is how are Byzantine coins represented versus Roman coins in a museum? And how do museums distinguish what is Byzantine and what is Roman? So what is a Byzantine coin and what is a Roman coin? And how do they each do this? I started reflecting on my past and my own experiences through museums. And these experiences led me to different museums in the past that when I started rethinking about how I looked at these, it got me really interested on identity issues. So I went to museums in Turkey where this picture is from. And basically these coins were Byzantine coins, but it was like an archaeological hunt to find them. You know, I had to go through a huge museum that was kind of weaving, and we were tucked in a far corner. There's about, you know, probably about 12 or 15 of them on display there. And they're just like Byzantine coins. And if we start thinking about how we set a time period to Byzantium, well, these few coins are supposed to represent anywhere from 700 years of history to 1100 years of history, which seems bizarre to me that these coins can all just be labeled Byzantine and this encompasses everybody that lived in this huge empire. When I went to the British Museum in London, I encountered the same thing. I mean, if anybody who's gone there will know that it is a massive museum with a huge amount of collections from various societies, and their Greek and Roman collection is very extensive. Now, I apologize for this particular picture because I know the quality is really bad on it. These are my own shots, but this one, I couldn't quite get a good picture of it. But in this collection at the British Museum, the only coins I could find that were actually labeled Byzantine was about 8 of them. That's it. And so they've kind of pushed this away in a corner too. And this is not to say that museums need to, just coming down hard on them, but it's just kind of this, how we othered this society and kind of put it away. And we relegate a lot of its history into this very small niche. And here in this sense is that, you know, we have, again, another 1100 years of history, say, and we put it into a corner and we say, here's some religious relics to go with it. And this is a Greek society that was Orthodox and we put some coins with it and there you go. So this kind of process got me thinking about a few things about here in Canada and what we do in museums as well. So collections like the Royal Ontario Museum, they do have an extensive Roman and Byzantine collection there as well. So this raised the question about Canada's multicultural diversity and the common cultural heritage that we as a society can share with each other. And what I mean by heritage is that it's the use of like the material culture that is passed down, the traditions that are passed down, and the languages that are passed down from these old ancient societies. So I look at coins and I go, coins to me are very tactile material culture. Everybody has used them, I would assume, most of us have. And we kind of have, we can attach different memories to coins and so forth. So all over the world, people tend to use coinage. And my brainstorming kind of came in and going, well, how can we then use this to relate the Byzantine world to the modern world? And I started thinking about the context of coins. And with context, it's a bit of a tricky question here because context can mean various things. What I mean here by context is in the archaeological sense, coins have three different contexts. They have a primary context, which is the actual minting of a coin. So where the coin's physically produced. They have a secondary context, which is the use and reuse of a coin. And this is just not by through trade and economy, but coins can actually were used for jewelry as well. And some coins have punctures through them where people would put chains through them, make bracelets, necklaces, and so forth, amulets. And this is a reuse of a coin. This has meaning, symbolism to people. And the third context is the deposition of the coin itself, which is when the coin comes into the archaeological record, whether it's placed there intentionally or it's just a stray loose find that we get. You get some context within the archaeological record where there's a ton of coins in a jar and that's a hoard placed in the ground for someone who is meant to come back and get it but never did. Or you might find some coins spread out like at Chatterhoyuk, where like in trenches like this particular one here, which I work in, are spread out and throughout the different parts of the site. And it kind of gives you an idea of the complexity of context. This particular trench that I excavated here, this trench has about minimum 500 to 600 years worth of history in this one photo. And that's because this particular trench runs from this wall over here from the late Roman period. It can even be said that we're maybe even over on the far, far right, getting into some Hellenistic material, but definitely later Roman period here and up into the middle Byzantine period up here, which is the gate structure that we're looking at. So when we start finding things in these kinds of contexts, it becomes very complex in terms of the relationships that these coins have, especially if they're found with other material culture. So thinking about this, I started thinking about context of them as a, in terms of where we put coins after we excavate them and what we do with them after we clean them up. And I started looking at museums as a context. And I actually argue that museums are a fourth and final context for most coins. A fourth and final archaeological context for coins. And so why does this matter? And then I got thinking about it, but before I move on to what that part is, I want to kind of draw your attention to this particular coin on the screen. Now, this coin is a half phallus of Justin II. It is a bronze coin, but it has an Arab overstrike on it. And why I wanted to point this one out is that it's not pretty. It's very corroded, decayed, and that's because it's bronze. But what we can get out of it is that it was in use. It was minted by a particular emperor. It was in use. Then it was stamped again by a particular group of people. It's an Arab overstrike pre-Islamic. And it was reused again. And then it was deposited in the archaeological context. Now, this particular coin, I don't know the provenance of because it's in our collections. And that is part of the problem too, in terms of museum collections, and I'll get to that as well. But for now, I just kind of wanted to demonstrate the diversity of use of this particular coin. So it was when I was able to resume my work here that I began to re-examining and imagining how to address the problem of representation and imagining how to address the problem of Byzantine coins in museums. So specifically, I wanted to address Canadian museums context, and not just because we live in Canada, but because I believe Byzantium in itself is a global cultural heritage. And since Canada is a very diverse and plural society, I believe it's only fitting that we present Byzantium as a common cultural heritage for the world to see and the world to share, given that Byzantium is a very diverse and multi-ethnic society. But this is not only this too. Byzantine coinage was a very stable coinage, and it was used across a very large geographical expanse. We have found Byzantine coins up in Scandinavia, Viking burials and so forth, and there's Byzantine coins being excavated in India and all the way into China, modern China, I should say. So this gives you the expanse of where these coins are traveling and the meaning of these coins, that they have a very stable value and people want to use them. And then at the same time, when we look at cultural heritage and excavations, I want to start thinking about this expanse of empire is all over the world, and we all can share this as a very a human cultural heritage. So, but the problem is that not most of the coins that we have are stored in vaults, and they're stored in trays and they're put away. So, and as I have here on the screen, dialogue about numismatics has remained an internal debate within Byzantine studies. So how Byzantinists represent and present Byzantine identity and culture to the modern world via museum exhibitions and galleries has not been fully addressed, especially here in Canada. So as I got into this project, that's the first thing I noticed. There's no dialogue about this. There's no dialogue between Byzantinists and Byzantine numismatists to the museums and so forth. Maybe behind the scenes, but there's nothing published. There's nothing that I can get access to. Maybe some oral dialogue between people, and that's about it. But this is a very big problem because it's very internal. And when we start looking at coins as a whole, especially in this picture, as you can see with the amount of coins that are there, it becomes very different. And so I asked myself, how can we approach this presentation differently? And looking at all these coins, I started thinking, well, if we show the amount of coins that are in use, the types of coins, and not just the gold ones and the good silver ones, but we show all the bronze and kind of have some way to have people interact with this, then we might be able to change the perceptions of who is using these coins and how these societies were actually developing and interacting with each other. So the next part of this, I kind of want to start looking at some of the coins I work with. And so what I do, what I have coming up are some examples of some of the coins that are generally on display, but I want to show you the problematic nature in terms of the identities that are associated with these coins. Excuse me. So some of the things I want to look at is who are these coins representing? And how are we presenting the identities associated to these coins? We'll start off with this particular coin here. This is of the Emperor Antoninus Pius of the early imperial period of Rome. It's a gold aureus, which is predates the solidus coin, which came into existence during the monetary reforms of the 3rd century under Diocletian. But look at the imagery on this coin is what I want you to start looking at here. So the coin itself is in Latin over on the inscription here telling us that Antoninus, is Augustus, pious and prosperous. But the image itself is very Greek in nature. And this is very common with a lot of the early Roman imperial coins and some of maybe the later Republic stuff is that the Romans liked to borrow from cultures. They loved it. They borrowed religions. They borrowed imagery and art, everything they could. So they really accepted into their culture a lot of other cultures and borrowed their ideas and used them to develop this Roman identity themselves. So Romanus is in a sense a very multi-ethnic and cultural identity. But as we move forward into the beginnings of what we call the Byzantine Empire, what you can see here is some images similar, but not quite exactly like the previous one. But what I want you to pay attention to here is that not just the imagery, but how we address these images and labels. So starting from viewers left over here, we have a gold solidus of Emperor Constantius II, son of Constantine, the founder of Constantinople, and the emperor who brought Christianity into what I would like to say the mainstream of Roman society. So this coin is from the year 330, well, he ruled, sorry, near 337, 361. It is designated as a Roman coin in the Roman Empire. We can see some of the characteristic traits of the previous, the side profile of the image, the robe toga that he's wearing, the headband laurels around him, and it's in Latin. Over here, same thing. This is Valentinian. This is the mid 4th century. Again, we're looking at a designation of the Roman Empire. The next one, what we have is of Honorius. Now, Honorius is the son of Theodosius I. And this is important because Theodosius I was the last sole ruler of the Roman Empire. So where one emperor controlled both the western portions and the eastern portions of the empire. When Theodosius passed away, the empire broke up into two halves, the western and the eastern. And Honorius, I believe, ruled the western half while his brother Arcadius ruled the east. Again, this is 393 to 423 is his rule, and it's designated as a Roman coin. And we can see from these images that these coins are very similar in profile. They're similar to the previous coin. But what's kind of interesting is when you start looking past this and past that designation of Roman, and we have to be careful though too at the same time, I'll pre-warn people, I'm going to use some modern labels to kind of give you a context of where these guys are from. But Constantius II was actually born in the region that is now modern Serbia. Valentinian was born in the region which is now modern Croatia. And Honorius was born in Constantinople, which is modern Istanbul. So these three fellows are born in very different geographical regions. They most definitely identified as Romans. But when we start looking closer into this problem of representation on coins, and we get further into this, you'll see this starts to become problematic in a sense of who comes from where, and then how we designate them. So the next set of coins is from the 5th through 6th century. So I'm going to go through the coins, and then I want everybody to kind of maybe see if they can spot something, and then I'll point it out when I go through at the end of the three coins. Obviously, the imagery of these coins are very not as well done, as you can see. This particular one is of Theodosius II, who ruled from 402 to 450. This one here is of Emperor Leo I, which is the mid to late 5th century. And then the one on the viewer's right here is a gold solidus of Justin I. And he goes into the 6th century just after the reforms of Anastasius that I talked about earlier. So when we look at these coins, the profiles of these coins are a little bit different. They're usually what we call a three-quarter profile. So a little bit more elaborate in the headdress. They look like they're wearing crowns. What we have is shields here on the viewer's right of the coin for each of these emperors. On the viewer's left of the coin, each emperor is holding a spear. So this is something different, something you don't really see in the previous Roman imperial coins. But what's interesting here with this is it's how we designate these. These are designated as Byzantine Empire coins, each one of these. So is this because it's stylistically it's different? So we figured, hey, this is a Byzantine coin. I mean, I had mentioned earlier that a lot of a Byzantine scholarship looks at these coins and goes 498 is when it begins. But 498 is, well, these guys are before that. So why are we designating these Byzantine? Is it because iconographically they're different? Or is it because the people who were doing this study and doing these labels thought the Byzantine Empire started at a particular time, so thereby they labeled these based on that? So when we start looking at coins, we have to really be very careful in terms of how we're studying these, because we have to take in the actual scholars and the people who are designating these labels biases in terms of how we're labeling it. And this goes back to the problem of using different chronologies to designate when the Byzantine Empire started. The other interesting thing is, look at this one here, and this is the one I'm hoping people picked up, is that Theodosius II ruled from 402 to 450, and we actually call it this a Byzantine coin. If we go back to the previous slide, Honorius ruled from 393 to 423, yet we call him a Roman coin. So there's an overlap in dates, but one's Roman and one's Byzantine. Both emperors would have definitely thought of themselves as Roman emperors, but we label them differently. And this distorts how we perceive the society and who lived within these societies. As we get into the 6th century coins, the 6th century is known for Justinian. One, he is the emperor who re-expanded the empire to try to get to Rome's former glory. He spent massive amounts of money doing this, built up a ton of churches, a ton of other infrastructures, waged wars everywhere, and reconquered these lands. So now we have an empire that has more people in it, more diverse ethnic groups, more diverse cultures, religious sects, and so forth. So what I want you to look at these coins is, here is the difference between these two coins. One is, again, the one on the viewer's right looks very Romanesque. It comes more from that traditional style of side profile, so forth. Excuse me. It's in Latin still, Usini. And then the one on the viewer's left is a very Eastern style representation. Not as classic, what we would say is classically designed in the Greek sense or in the old style of the side profiles and so forth. It's very it has a totally different feel to it. But this is actually Justinian I on viewer's left, and this is also Justinian I on viewer's right as well. They're the same guy. So they're different in profile, but they're the same person. So the question then becomes, who is the target audience here? Like, these pictures are targeting, they have political messages behind them, they have social messages behind them. And those who are using these coins see these images and are getting these different types of messages in terms of who's ruling and what they're trying to say. And so when we look at the coins too, even though they're different pictures, they're the same emperor, but they're targeting different people. And thus we have to look at the diversity within the society of who's using these coins. So moving on into the 7th century, we got more coins here. And this is the one on the viewer's left is a gold solidus of the Emperor Heraclius. Now he's more known for fighting the Persians, the Sasanian Empire in the 7th century, as well as facing the beginning of the Islamic invasions. His coin is pretty interesting. It's a different, again, a different style. What we see here is Heraclius is on the left-hand side, viewers left. He's bearded, he has his robe, he has his crown. What we have on the right-hand side is one of his sons. And what he's doing here in this image is telling the empire that this is the person who's next in line and rule. And so this is becomes a very traditional way of doing this from this point on. Is what we see is these emperors start putting sons or two sons on a coin to establish hereditary rule. What I wanted to do mostly with this main slide is look at the coin on the right-hand side. Again, this coin here is what's called a silver millar resinian. I can never pronounce that word right, so I apologize. But this coin is actually from the 9th century, the late 9th century. And it's during a period called the iconoclast period or iconomachy. It is a coin that has no images of Christ on it whatsoever. There's nothing on there except for a cross on the reverse side of the coin. This is because in this period that they banned the worship of icons and the worship of pictures. But what's interesting about this particular coin is the writing on the coin. And the writing on the coin says, Basil, which is the emperor, and Constantine, which is his son, faithful believers, kings of the Romans. And that's what I want you to look at right here. This word here, Basilis Romeo. This is kings of the Romans. So this coin is telling you something. Yet, we label it Byzantine Empire down here. But they thought of themselves as Romans. These people within the empire believed that they were Romans and they were the descendants of the Roman Republic, the Imperial Rome, and into the 9th and even into the 11th and 12th centuries. These people identified as Romans. Now, this doesn't mean all people within the society identified as Romans, but again, the purpose of this is to show the misnomer of the use of the word Byzantine and Byzantium to identify these coins, because this society never technically existed in the sense of the term Byzantine. So now I want to switch it up a tiny bit here, because female representation in coins is something that it struck a chord in me, in a sense that it's something I'm doing as a side project, but eventually will I want to do more deeper scholarly work with. And the reason for this is because when we look at female representation in coins, we usually attest the Roman empress with a Roman emperor. We don't usually attest them solely by themselves. So when we look into collections, and I should have done this, but I apologize, but I don't have an actual picture of how information about the coin itself, but we'll say that, like this one particular here, Julia Somaeus is the empress and mother of the emperor Elagabalus. So this is interesting in the sense that we have to associate her with a Roman emperor. Why can't we associate her by herself? Obviously she came into existence by her before her son the Roman emperor, but I mean, this is the problem with when we do these, what we do with women in coins. The other thing, what really struck me about this coin and what I really wanted to point out about it, was where this particular person was from. So this coin is designated as a silver denarius. It's a Roman coin We designate her as a Roman empress, which she was, but this particular person is from the modern area of Syria. She comes from Syrian nobility. She was married into the Roman aristocracy, but she was a noble woman herself. But yet we will designate these women as just a Roman empress who is attached to a Roman emperor, or this is the mother of a Roman emperor, or this is the daughter of a Roman emperor. Well, this particular person comes from Syria. She has a different cultural background, different ethnic background, different all kinds of things. We have all kinds of accounts like this. There are people who are Berbers who are within the Roman aristocracy. There are Arabs. There's all sorts of people. So when we start just attaching singular identities to coins, it becomes problematic to just kind of simplify who these people were. And in terms of female representation, there's very little done in terms of Roman Empire and the Byzantine Empire. What's also interesting with the Byzantine Empire, there's very little female representation on coins, period. So what little representation there's not much done in terms of studies. So there are coins of the Empress Theodora, who was married to Justinian. There is also, which I just did see how I associate it with a particular emperor. There's also an empress named Irene, who has her own coins, who came to power through a regency and held on to that power. And very strong, very cunning woman. She has coins as well. But these coins they're not studied too much. And we don't look into the backgrounds of these women. And we don't really we don't really understand their cultural backgrounds, with their ethnic backgrounds, their identities, how they identified themselves. We just throw these identities to them, Byzantine, Roman. And this is problematic. So that being said, a little thought experiment. What I wanted to do here was kind of get you a sense of how problematic this is in terms of identity and coins. And what we have here is two coins of the Queen Elizabeth II. One on the right is a penny. The other one is, I believe, a quarter. What the main thing here is, think about it as society has collapsed. We're buried, just like you would see an old society like the Roman Empire, Greeks, Persians, and we're excavating it. You come up across these two coins. One's a penny, one's a quarter, and they both have the head of the Queen Elizabeth. You dig a little bit deeper. The coin on the right, the penny, is actually from Canada. The coin on the left actually is from Australia. So how do we represent the people attached to these coins? Who are the people that are using these coins? Should we just say Queen Elizabeth, head of the British monarchy, representative of all the Commonwealth, represents all the people within the Commonwealth, and that all people within the Commonwealth identified as British? Or do we represent it as she's the representative of Canadians or Australians? Well, who are the Australians and Canadians? These are very multi-ethnic and very pluralistic societies. So as this is how I want you to look at Byzantine coins. Queen Elizabeth has ruled for 70 years. The Byzantine Empire, if you go from founding Constantinople to its end, is 1100 years. How do we relegate this society with a millennium of history, diversity of multi-ethnic groups who use the name Romans, to Byzantine? Again, this is why some of the problems I want to address throughout this period. So the way I started thinking about doing this is through digital visualization. And what I did here in the practicum was I started looking at how we can get people involved, more of a, let's say, a public outreach. I wanted to do projects that people can actually be involved with. I want projects that people can kind of engage with themselves through experiential learning modalities. So what I'm going to do here is kind of quickly go through these two images and then show you a final product. Now, thanks to a particular individual at the University of Calgary, Jeremiah Baker, who helped me out a lot with this particular project. We started doing 3D imagery. And what we have here is the picture, the previous picture I showed you of Antoninus Pius is right here. And what we did was we took a ton of different photographs from various angles, close-ups, different shots all around the coin, and we try to mesh them together. And all this yellow is little triangles. And what it does, it uses these geometric points to mesh all the images together to create a 3D image. This is image is kind of on the right is the rendering of this. And what I'm going to do quickly is I got to stop my share, and then I'm going to bring up another image so you can see what we were trying to do. So just 1 second, please. Oh, sorry about that. Little glitch, and we should have this here. There we go. So hopefully everybody can see this. This particular coin is again of Antoninus Pius. Antonia, oh my God, I'm done, too much talking. Antoninus Pius, thank you. This is of him, but this particular coin is actually from the Sarajevo Museum. This was the end product that we were trying to get to. Unfortunately, we just don't have the technology at the moment at the university to really pull this off, but it was worth a try. But this is actually a 3D image of the coin. So this is part of the project of what I wanted to do was make an image that we can digitally upload into a collections gallery and that anybody can have access to. So both scholars and the public, because there's so many coins in vaults that people don't get to see, we don't get a true understanding of the diversity of imagery on coins, the diversity of people on coins, and who they're representing. And by doing these kind of digital 3D images of coins, we can start doing this and uploading them. At the same time, for the people who want to study coins or look at coins, it becomes very engaging, especially in a period where we're in COVID, where we can't go anywhere and we can't get into some of these collections to see them. This is a great way to get people engaged. At the same time, when you go to museums like the pictures I've shown you, they're very two-dimensional. You see a obverse, which is the front facing of the coin, and sometimes they'll have the same coin with the reverse, the other side of the coin showing you, but sometimes they don't. They just show you the one side. So how do you know what's on the other side? How can you interact with that? It's behind a case, you can't touch it. With the 3D imagery, I mean, you can't touch the coin, but you do get a sense of the tactile texture of the coin itself. And you can see the different nuances and the shapes of the coins, the imagery on the back, the lettering, even different scratch marks, which is a great tool that, like, in a sense of understanding the wear and tear of a coin. So if I was trying to zoom in on a particular point here, it's hard to see, but like these kind of scratches here, I mean, these things are kind of, they can be important in terms of understanding overstrikes, who's using whose coin, the reuse of the coin. And so therefore these 3D images are massive, massive help to what we're trying to do. So in terms of my future research, what I'm planning on doing is taking the Byzantine coin collection at the Nickle Galleries and hopefully digitizing all the coins, there's about just under 200 of them, into a 3D model and start loading these into a collections process that everybody has access to. And this will help us greatly understand some of the nuances of these coins, who's on them, and then just the different stylistic characteristics of them. So I'm just going to go back to sharing my other screen. Continue on. So just to continue on. So this is kind of some of the processes that I wanted to go through. One of the other things I started thinking about during this was, what can I do outside of the academics? What can I do for myself that kind of presents, that gives people more access to what I'm doing while I'm doing it? So I started up a blog called Rogue History. And what this is meant to do is not just a blog about coins, but it's a blog about just the kind of the how the academic mind works sometimes, how my academic mind works. It's more of a stream of consciousness. And so I started kind of writing about my journey through the practicum in this blog. And what I've been kind of doing is going through each process, I started learning about, you know, how do I want to present this stuff to people? You know, how do I want to make this accessible to people? So this is kind of the part of the point of this particular blog was to get that a different side of the academic's perspective of how coins are treated and the processes that I'm going through in terms of this particular practicum. So that being said, I just want to kind of conclude here that the practicum gave me a lot to think about how we approach coins, but also how we approach coins here in Canada. And it gave me a look into a society that like Canada, who is very multicultural, very diverse, and go, well, what do we do for a kind of like a common heritage that we all can share? And I think something that would actually help us, you know, create the, you know, the relationships that we are looking for and not divide everybody. A society that can kind of bring people together and not polarize. And when we get into these museums, we always separate these things like, you know, Roman, Greek, and, you know, Persian and so forth. Well, Byzantium is very complex. And if we start looking at the diversity of the society itself, then we can start maybe bringing a different approach to history, bringing a different approach to archaeology, and therefore bringing a different approach to how we present this stuff to people in the general public. So that being said, what I took away from the practicum was that Byzantine numismatics can provide a link between the modern world and the past. And money, specifically coins, are very tangible. And again, like I've said before, tactile material culture that all humankind can relate to and share as a common cultural heritage. So what I want to say to people out there, and I did this in my last talk and I will do it again, is just that for people who are interested in these things, or people who are maybe thinking about going back to school to study, something I did, I went back to university after 14, 15 years and just kind of went into this journey, is that I want people to start exploring the different avenues that you can go through a practicum, be curious, start trying to question things. Just don't take everything in as affirm, it's definitely Roman, it's definitely, start questioning, be curious about it, and take a chance at what you're trying to do. Because without that, you just don't know where you're going to end up going and where it's going to take you. And for me, I went into the university to study First World War, and now I'm a big coin nerd who studies Byzantine coins. So like with that, I'd like to say thank you very much and appreciate you wataching my talk. And just want to say a special thanks to the Calgary Public Libraries for hosting this. Marina Fisher, who helped me through my practicum, who guided me and taught me. Dr. Cassis, who is my supervisor, and Jeremiah Baker, who is the emerging technology specialist who helped me with the 3D imagery. So thank you very much. And that's it.
Thank you so much, Scott. That was very interesting. I truly enjoy your presentation. We do have some questions coming in. Mm-hmm. So the first one is from Sydney. Hi, Scott. Thank you for your talk. Do you think that another context could be the black market sale of coins, coins being traded in underground antiquity markets? If so, what would that context look like and how could that affect our understanding of how the life of a coin has evolved? How can that speak to how our current culture values these coins?
That's a great question. Thanks to Sydney. She's a peer and very close friend of mine. So I should have known she was going to throw me a hardball question. So this is something I've actually grappled with during the practicum when I was looking at the cultural heritage component of it, of how Greek museums were representing coins and creating this link between the modern day state and the past. And coins are like one of these things that are traded all over the world. And there's a black market for it, and then there's a normal market for it. And then you have the scholarly component of things. And it is very problematic. I don't have an an answer. I would say, yes, I do maybe agree to a point that we can look at the black market and the normal market as a context for where these coins are coming from. But it does become, the black market itself is very problematic. And this is something that if you did look at it as a context, it's something the scholarly field has to take a look at, because most of the coins that we get, like say in the Nickle Galleries, I'm not saying the Nickle Galleries got them illegally, but like say collections like the Nickle Galleries, they're getting coins from collectors, private collectors. But we don't know a lot of times where these private collectors are getting their coins. Mm-hmm. So some of these coins come from illicit markets. Some of them come from Jerusalem, some come from Turkey, some come from Greece. But they're, what's happening is you're getting looters going into excavation sites, pulling up coins or whatnot, or finding them, trading them on the black market, and then they get into the collections of private collectors or establishments like the university. Hopefully that answers your question.
While we are there, and you mentioned the nickel collections, what coins does the nickel collections have?
So they do have, we have actually a wide range from the very beginning, the very first coins that were minted in Greece, in the, which is, well, not, I shouldn't say Greece, but mint Greek coins. They were minted in the western part of Asia Minor, which is modern Turkey. They have coins from the Roman period, the Persian period, Islamic periods, Byzantine. We have Canadian money. We have money, different types of forms of money. So just not coins. We have bills. Mm-hmm. We also have things that were traded as money. So we have a big kind of, I don't even know how you describe it, but it's like this big stick of salt, basically, that's wrapped in wood. And that was actually a currency as well, because salt was very highly prized back in the ancient world. So before really money came along, like coins, salt was a very high value traded commodity. So these things were currency as well. Cattle would be currency at the same time, but obviously we don't have cattle there, but but these are some of the things we have at the Nickle Galleries.
Oh, that's very interesting. Thank you. So the next question is from Nikolaus. Why does the art on the coins decline? Did they become more rushed, or is it because there isn't a need for an accurate depiction? Or is it because of a declining importance of emperors in the wake of Christianity?
No. So I would definitely say it's not because of the declining importance of emperors in the wake of Christianity. I mean, the Byzantine emperors were Christian. They were the height of the kind of like that in between of God and the rest of society. That's how they looked at themselves. So it doesn't, wouldn't say it's due to the importance. I don't have a real good answer in terms of why the imagery seems to decline. It could be just they just didn't have the same artisans who were crafting these. Mm-hmm. When you think of coins, and Marina's talk next, I think. Is it next week or the week after? She goes into the art of coins and the iconography of these are they're very well handcrafted. And as you saw in the digital image, I mean, that's a coin that's been worn down and stuff, but yet it's very detailed. So part of it could be just the craftsmanship. Maybe they just don't have the same types of craftsmen to doing this. Part of it could be the production, rushed production of it. I mean, there are various theories about why this is happening, but I can't give a definite answer that would say, yes, this is why it happened. Because again, this happens over hundreds of years. Mm-hmm. And this becomes a problem where we compress time to go, you know, these coins look like this, but they expand over such a wide variety of time. So there's multiple factors that could be doing this.
Thank you. And I think that we got pretty good idea through your presentation, but could you tell us a little bit more about why do you feel that Byzantium is a global heritage?
I want to look at it in a way that kind of bring it back into the fold that it, because of the multicultural diversity of the empire itself and those who lived within it, the broad span of which the period that the empire lasted, it touched everywhere across the globe. And as I said, we find coins in China and northern Scandinavia and so forth. So these people were trading everywhere and they were interacting with everybody. And the various cultures that came within, the various ethnicities, the various groups, races, so forth. I mean, it's very complex. And I think when we start stigmatizing by saying Byzantine, and it's been orientalized and pushed to this area of the Middle East, or just on the fringes of the Middle East, it's very colonialistic. It's very, and I want to, I think coins are a great way to try to deconstruct these kind of colonial narratives of what these people were, right? And I think the only way to do that is also understand that it is a society that touched everywhere around the world. Therefore, it's a society that everybody has a connection to. And it's not to say we should claim a heritage, but what I'm saying is, a human species, it's a heritage that we can all enjoy, right? And I mean, as much as you want to look at UNESCO as a conservation group, we have to also understand there is also these kind of colonial tones to it, as the West trying to preserve what we think is important. But at the same time, it's the moral, it's the philosophy behind what they're trying to do. And it's a human experience, a human culture. And this is kind of why I think it's important.
Thank you. Thank you. I would like to invite our audience to send us more questions. And we do have one from Hamza. A bit of a tangential question and more future oriented, but your talk got me thinking about how little we pay attention to the currency we use on a day-to-day basis, and how digitization of money would impact culture, and how modern governments will adapt their messaging on currency. What are your thoughts? And this, I apologize, this came from Hifsa.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, that's a great question, because it's quite relevant in terms of how, especially in the last year where everybody is very digital now, like it's very hard to exchange currency anymore, and especially money. And in most cultures, like let's say the United States, like they still have like, you know, $2 bills and $1 bills, I believe. So coins are almost this kind of like thing that we've started looking at, in a sense that they're heavy and cumbersome, and you put them in a jar somewhere and eventually you cash them in, right? And so it kind of shows the, in a sense, when we start looking at how we're shifting to this electronic kind of currency, it might show you that the importance of what these images are on these things. They're not, they don't maybe resonate to people as much, and that's because we have all forms of communications, a way of talking to each other. In the past, this is a way of getting a message out, right? So images are very important on coins in the past. But I guess, as you would say, since the invention of the printing press and these kind of, these the mass production of information that creates these communities among people, they can talk to each other through this, these images maybe are not as important. And therefore, we can see start seeing that shift into the electronic world as well.
Thank you. Also, I wanted to ask, what would be your favorite coin?
One of my favorite coins, I don't have an image of it right now. I mean, I could find it and pull one up, but it's really interesting coin that, see here while I talk about it, see if I can pull it up for you.
Sure.
Let me actually I found it. That shows you how keen I am on getting this. share that. So can you see it?
Yes.
So this particular coin is a bronze coin, copper coin. Now I love this coin for one reason. It has various uses, and this is what really drove me to this coin. And it's only until like maybe a few days ago that me and Marina were looking at this coin, and we're actually going, hey, I think this is actually mislabeled. So, excuse me, it was originally labeled as a coin of Constantine I in year two of his reign. But what happened was, as I started looking at the coin, can you see me zooming in?
Yes.
So as I started looking at this coin, there's overstrikes on this coin, which we knew they were there. But we were trying to, we just kind of, the person who labeled this was very a very prominent coin collector who knew his stuff. but I start recognizing something down here, and in terms of the coin. And what happened was, I was like, that looks like an overstrike that might be Arab or Islamic. So we start digging a little bit deeper into this coin, because it's like, well, if it's a Constantine coin, how is this possible, right? Like, did someone pick it up later on and reuse it? Well, it's like 3 centuries later, so why would they? It doesn't have value. But what we started noticing is that this particular overstrike, the one that's on the bottom of the coin that looks like a cross, and has a kind of like a almost an R looking shape on the left side, and another line crossing going on an angle to, like, say, the 1 o'clock position, that's actually a counter stamp of what we believe is the Emperor Heraclius from the 6th century. So, which means this coin is probably not of Constantine. So this is what really fascinates me about this coin, because we also have a number on there, which is 4. But the other cool thing about this coin is that puncture. And it's a very modern puncture, because it's very clean. The cut in it is just like, when I look at it super close, it's like almost like a machine did it. But this shows you that this coin was once had an initial life. It was counter stamped by Heraclius, who used it again. Then it probably fell off the chart somewhere. And then someone found it and punctured it and used it as either a necklace, bracelet, amulet, whatever. Uh-huh. It has a very long life. Then it goes into collections. So it goes into the hands of a private collector, and who donates it to us. So this coin is absolutely fascinating for its reuse throughout the centuries. And if it is true that this coin is from Constantine, I mean, it's the reuse of it is just phenomenal.
It's very pretty.
That's one of my favorite coins.
It's very pretty. Yeah. I can see why someone would use it as a pendant. So we still have some time. Please send us questions if you still have and would like to. You can also raise a hand. We can unmute you, and or you can unmute yourself and ask Scott a question yourself, if that's what you prefer. Also, if something comes up later, I think Scott will be happy to answer some other questions. Yeah. And you have a blog as well?
Yes, the blog. And I will say the blog has some parental discretion advice posts in it. Just there's some flowery language I like to use. But it's just me being fun. And it may get you more intrigued in terms of what I do behind the scenes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so again, that was a wonderful presentation. Thank you so much for your time preparing it and doing it tonight. We have another question from Sydney.
Of course.
How does examining female on coins differ from our examination of man?
Well, it's tricky, because for me, it shouldn't be different. Like, we should be giving them equal weight. But as I had alluded earlier in the presentation, I think it's because, like, one of the things that strikes me is that we always associate it with some form of emperor, right? And that, in turn, kind of puts these masculine tropes to the coin. It doesn't give the female representation any independence on its own. Now, I mean, we have to obviously look at these coins and go, okay, the emperor did sign off to have these coins made. Some of these coins of females are actually made after the female has died. So Helena, of Constantine's mother, was deified in a sense that she was put on a coin after she had passed away. There's a few other empresses who are immortalized on coins after they have passed. So they are important figures. They have representations to that society, and they have meaningful symbols and so forth, and to the people, and memory, meaningful memories to the people. So, but the fact that we just always seem to attach it to a male figure is problematic in how we address their representations, right? And so we have to be a little more careful in how we look at these female figures on coins.
Thank you.
Thanks, Sid.
And there's another question from Hifsa. During the iconoclastic time period, do you think we may have lost coins that may have been melted down and redesigned?
Yeah, definitely. And this is actually true throughout the period. So it doesn't have to just do with the iconoclast periods. It's throughout the whole empire. I mean, coins are melted down and reused for lots of things, right? If they're being debased, then they'll be melted down with metals added to them to debase the value of the coin. So this is definitely true. And it becomes even harder to understand in the sense that what we have, the so-called Byzantine Dark Period, which is roughly around the 7th, 8th century, we have very little evidence of coin, especially throughout Anatolia. There's just absolutely nothing. And at our site at Chatterhoyuk, we have a huge gap from Justinian Justin II is our last coin. And then there's a gap until the 11th century. So, I mean, this is problematic because it's a sixth century at the latest. And then we get into the 11th century. So there's a huge gap there. Now, that doesn't mean people weren't using coins. But what was happening? Were they just being, was the currency smaller? Were they melting them down and reusing it, or so forth?
And how is that determined that that has been done? How?
That they've been remelted down?
Yeah.
I really don't think you can determine that in a sense that looking at a coin, and I mean, you would probably have to have some highly specialized equipment that looks at the minerals within the coin itself, but I don't think you really can do that at this moment. We just, part of it is we might not even just, we just haven't found the evidence yet. So it's hard to say. In terms of the iconoclast period, it is quite possible that a lot of these things were melted down so the read be done, because they don't want the images out there, right? They're not allowed. It's basically illegal.
Yeah. Well, thank you. Thank you again to you, and thank you for our audience for joining us tonight. I would just like to remind you that we have two more programs in this series, The Ancient World. Please visit our website to check out those two and to sign up for them. It'll be also Wednesdays at 7 p.m. And also, please check out other programs that we offer online on our website. As I said, this has been recorded and it will be available later on our YouTube channel. Well, again, Scott, thank you so much. On behalf of Calgary Public Library, this was very, very interesting.
Thanks for having me. I really appreciate it. It's been a great time.
You're welcome. Thank you. Okay, have a good night, everyone.
Goodbye.